This coming Tuesday is July 4th, and it's a day that our nation celebrates its birth. 241 years. And hopefully we appreciate the qualities that has made us a great nation. The unique country that we are. In addition to our cookouts and fireworks that are usually associated with the 4th of July, the word freedom, say that with me, freedom, likely will come to our minds. Freedom is the foundation of what we call our Independence Day. Freedom continues to be at the heart of what it means to be an American citizen. To be American is to be free person, free in delivering our words, free to do what we will, to pursue our dreams. Freedom to be what God would have us to be. But freedom is a word that also strikes us at a different reason, for a different reason, especially as Christians. Because freedom is something that is the key to our faith in Christ Jesus. Just like the Bill of Rights and the Declarations of Independence are considered our ultimate documents of freedom as a United States citizen, the Bible, the B-I-B-L-E, is our source of freedom as a human being. We were created in the image of God. So ultimately, freedom is not found in moving away from that image, but living within. The closer we conform to the image of God, the freer we become. I'm going to say that again. The closer we conform to the image of God, the freer we become. The further we drift from it, the more of our freedom diminish. A train is free when it stays on its track. If it jumps the track, it is free of the rails, but not free in the most important way. Because it'll go nowhere, will it? Eventually, it's going to come to a stop. Even though the train jumped track, it's free, but not truly free. Just like our nation, we have areas of vulnerability. The enemy wants to find your weakest spot. When you are spiritually hungry, you are a prime target for Satan. And how do you get spiritually hungry? One of the ways is ignore God. When you buried your, I got it in my pocket. When you bury your nose into this, more than you bury your nose into this, you become spiritually hungry. Now, this could be TV screen. It could be in many other things. When we spend more time on other things than we do God's word, we become spiritually hungry, and we become a prime target for Satan. When you are gullible, if you don't know your enemy, you are open to lies that he will feed you. When you don't know your enemy, and you're gullible, and you don't know the word of God, the enemy can come in and feed you lies and you'll believe it. When you are hurt or discouraged, he will lure you down the wrong path. When you are hurt and discouraged, he will lure you down the wrong path. The Bible tells us in 2 Corinthians 10:5, Cast down imagination and every high thing that exalts itself against the knowledge of God, and bring into captivity every thought to the obedience of Christ. Very important words there in 2 Corinthians 10:5. Cast down those imaginations and every high thing that exalts itself against the knowledge of God, and bring into captivity every thought to the obedience of Christ. So in other words, the writer is saying here, let's contain those thoughts, amen, and concentrate upon the Word of God. Don't let them go wild. Don't let them go out astray. Don't let them jump the track, so to speak. Stay on track. Stay on track. Spiritual warfare. Main playing field is the mind, thoughts, and imaginations. But where the Spirit of God is, where the Spirit of the Lord is, where the Spirit of the Lord is, the Bible says there is liberty. 2 Corinthians 3:17. We're talking about liberty. We're talking about freedom. We're here today on this 4th of July weekend to celebrate that freedom of our nation. But we're here today in the house of the Lord to celebrate the freedom in which the Lord Jesus Christ gave to each and every one who has called upon his name. It is by the presence of God's Holy Spirit that we are given that freedom that we can rejoice in today. And if you have your Bibles, I want you to turn with me now to Galatians chapter 5 and verse 1. Galatians 5, verse 1. Stand fast, therefore, the writer says. Stand fast, therefore, in the liberty wherewith Christ has made us free. And be not entangled again with the yoke of bondage. The yoke of bondage here means our sinful lifestyle. Don't be entangled again with the old yoke of bondage in which Christ has set you free. Because when you called upon his name and you asked him to come into your heart, he broke the bondage, amen. He set you free. And don't be, amen, a prey to fall victim again to Satan's snares. You know, we try to do our spring cleaning. Anybody with me? And sometimes during the winter, you know, you get moss and you get mold. There you go. Help me out a little bit. You know, you get those things growing on the outside of your house. And sometimes, I have yet to do mine because I've been delaying and putting it off. But you got spider webs and you got all of that growing alongside of your gutter work and stuff like that. And you like to get it cleaned off. You like to pressure wash it and get it cleaned up. Anybody with me? Amen. Anybody with me? And so we have to do that sometimes. And you know, one of the things I dread in doing so is dragging the hose out, the water hose. Y'all know the water hose? When you drag that water hose out, especially when you get over 100 foot of a hose out, you know, and you're trying to, get it to work, because you drag that hose around the house, you know, and you think everything's all right. You climb up the ladder there, and you go to shoot the water, and nothing go. Anybody with me on that? Well, what happened? What happened? Got a kink in the hose. You're hot, and you're sweaty. You climb back down the ladder, and you got to go and find the kink in the hose. And you find, you know, you have to walk back around the house, you know, where they drug it from, and you find the kink in it, and you finally get back up on the ladder. And sometimes, you know, there's a second kink that you didn't see. You climb all the way back up there and go, gone. You have to climb back down again. But until all the kinks are out, you won't have the proper pressure to wash off the dirt. Sometimes in our life, Satan creates kinks in it, that our flowing of our spirit with God's spirit doesn't always happen. We got to get the kinks out for us to have a free, flowing, spiritual journey with our God. And our Lord knows, if I'm going to ever get a kink out, I want to get it out of my spiritual being. Because I want to flow, amen, with God. I want to go in the direction God is going in. I want to be able to help others, amen, along life's journey. I want to be able to share the word of God with others that need him. So, Lord, help us today to learn how to get the kinks out of our lives. And we're going to talk about some of the kinks, because kinks can keep you from enjoying the freedom in which God intended for you to do, to have, rather. Amen? So, first thing we know, if the enemy can't stop you, he will distract you. If the enemy cannot stop you, he will distract you. Now, the Bible tells me that I'm more than a conqueror in Christ Jesus. He tells you that. So we are more than conquerors in the name of Jesus Christ. But if the devil cannot stop you, he will cause a kink to distract you. What is those distractions? When it's time to pray, the telephone may ring. When it's time to read the Word of God, a favorite TV show may come on the air. When it's time to go to the house of God, a friend may stop by. But we don't do that. We open our house door and say, come on in. Well, was you going somewhere? Well, I was going to church, but never mind. Friend, today, if you're not spending quality time in the Bible, in Bible study, Bible reading, and prayer with God, then you're vulnerable to being distracted and kinked by Satan. Mark, Gospel, chapter 4, verse 19 says, and the cares of this world and the deceitfulness of riches and the lust of other things entering in, it chokes the word. It chokes the word and it becomes unfruitful. Mark 4, 19, and the cares of this world, once again, and the deceitfulness of riches and the lust of other things entering in choke the word and it becomes unfruitful. The Bible says you can go after the things of the world, and many are. There are many people has been distracted by the glamour of the world and all the things that it has to offer. They have gotten forgotten God. The lust of the eyes, the lust of the flesh, and the pride of life has caught them. It's kinked their hose. They can't concentrate on nothing else. They are concentrating on the things of the world, and it choked the word of God out of them. Some of the most dangerous distractions are those that don't make much noise but creep in while we lay at rest. So making some simple personal choices will help with this. First, make a point to read God's word so distraction doesn't kink your hose. Make a point. If you make a point to do something, then most likely you will do it. Before all other activities, always make a point to read God's word. Start your day like that. I had to learn that. I mean, I used to be one like to stay in the bed forever. Anybody with me? I mean, you don't get up till after 12 o'clock. And a minister that I had, you know, I would promise to help him when I was growing up, you know, he would be down to pick me up, and my mom and them would say, he's still in the bed. And one of the things he would tell me, he says, you're sleeping your life away. I didn't realize that back then, but now I do. You're sleeping your life away. Your younger years, you're able to do more. Sleep in the older years, because that's about all you can do. Feel like, yeah, or you feel like doing it. But, you know, the importance is get up early in the morning. Why? Jesus got up early in the morning. Get into God's word before everything else distracts you from doing so. And I got scripture for you. Matthew 6:33, seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all other things be added to you. So what does that mean? Seek God first in the morning. Seek God first in the morning. Seek God first in the morning. Say that with me. Seek God first in the morning. So make a point to get up early and get before God, amen, in his word and in prayer. Find a place of solitude where it is absolutely quiet, where you can meditate and pray without disturbance. Here's a point that will help us with that. Not only exercise will help us with it, but this will also help us with it. Fasting. And you say, well, what do you have to quit eating? No, you don't have to quit eating. Fasting can include a lot of other things, too. One of them is eating. If you can skip a meal and pray and seek God, that'd be a good thing. But what about skipping the Facebook or the TV or other things that are coming into our life and take that time to memorize a verse of Scripture? Just saying. Amen. Because these things, if we implement them in our life, we won't be distracted. And our hose won't have a kink of distraction. Second of all, recognize and remove temptation, because temptation can kink us up too. Recognize and remove temptation. How can we be free of temptation? Typically, we can't 100% of the time, but there are things that can be done to eliminate that. There's no safe distance from temptation. The Bible says all of us are tempted. The tug of sin is great. Jesus himself was tempted. And Satan tried to make him sin. But every time temptation came Christ's way, Christ used Scripture. That's why it's important not to be distracted and have that first kink, because if you know the Word of God, then you won't fall prey to the second kink, which is temptation. Every time Christ was tempted, he used Scripture in Matthew's Gospel, chapter 4. It is written. It is written, he told Satan. It is written. Mind you, Satan knows Scripture too, so sometimes he'll quote it back, but you better know it better than him. And remember, there's no safe distance from temptation. All of us will be tempted from time to time. But before yielding to temptation, you usually go through certain stages by neglecting prayer, Bible reading, and you become indifferent toward God. And when you do this, it intensifies the danger that you will face. You'll find yourself drawn to it like a moth to a flame. Then you begin to rationalize your disobedience and think, nobody knows. What's the harm? What harm would it do? And all of these things the devil will feed to you. Nobody's looking, so go ahead and do it. Drink that beer. Do that. Do this. Nobody cares. Nobody's around. But let me tell you, God sees you, and God knows all things. You can't hide from God. So be aware of Satan's tactics that he'll use by rationalizing your decision. Jesus prayed, and he prayed this prayer, that you may not enter into temptation. In Mark's Gospel 14:38, watch ye and pray, lest ye enter into temptation. The spirit is truly willing, but the flesh is weak, he told Peter. Peter, you got a great desire in your heart, but Satan can kink you up in a minute in temptation if you're not careful. You're not careful. Jesus told his disciples that prayer was one of the surest ways to guard against vulnerability and Satan's attacks and temptation. He taught the apostles how to pray in Matthew 6:13. He said, lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from what? Evil. Deliver us from?
Evil.
Who's evil?
Satan.
And the worldly ways. So pray for strength before temptation comes. The secret to overcoming temptation, lean less on yourself and more on God. Lean less on yourself and more on God. The third and final thing, beware of false teachers, because they can really kink you up. Amen. They can really kink you up. So don't let the enemy, amen, distract you and kink your hose. Don't let him, second of all, amen, distract you from reading God's word and getting to what God's word, amen, have you to be and what he would have you to do. Don't let him use temptation to kink you up. And third of all, don't let him use false teachers to kink you up. Oh, do we have false teachers today? Absolutely. They're in our main churches. Peter devoted most of 2 Peter to warning against false teachers. Matter of fact, the book we just studied on Wednesday night, Jude, devoted his whole entire writings on that fact, amen, to beware of false teachers. Paul's final words to the Ephesians elders warned them in Acts Gospels 20, 28 and 30, take heed therefore unto yourself and to all the flock over that which the Holy Ghost hath made you overseers to feed the church of God which he has purchased with his own blood. For I know this, that after my departing shall grievous wolves enter among you and not spare in the flock. He's warning them, beware that false teachers, after he would leave, would come in and try to disrupt and kink up the church. Hello? But he says, also on your own self shall men arise speaking perverse things to draw away the disciples after them. The secret to recognizing false teachers, lean less on yourself and more on God. Lean on his word to expose the false teachers. Because the Bible tells you how to recognize them. If they preach any other thing other than Christ, shedding and atoning blood, they are false prophets. If they teach any other thing than which Christ has taught in his word, they are false prophets. There are many today who is going against God's word, especially in this day and society that we live in, about marriage. And you know that. That's on the forefront of the news. Marriage in the Bible is between man and a woman. They constitute a family. That constitutes a home. That constitutes God's way. Man and a woman. Man and a woman. Not same-sex marriages. So when you see churches standing up and saying, hey, it's okay, you can live any lifestyle that you want to, God still loves you, that's totally against God's word. And let me be the first to say that, amen, if I may. That's false teaching. You can't do anything you want to and still go to heaven. The Bible tells me if I'm going to get to heaven, I got to come through Jesus Christ. And if I come through Jesus Christ, I'm going to be like Christ. I'm going to have a Christ likeness about me. The water that flows through my hose will represent the water that flows through him, and that is a holy lifestyle. A holy lifestyle. Be holy as I'm holy, the Bible teaches us. How can I do that? By staying close to God and staying close to his word and applying the word. We can read the word all day, but unless we apply it to our life, then the word has no effect to us. We'll still be kinked up. We have to have, amen, the word of God alive within us. That means read, heed, and obey. Obey God. Obedience is better than sacrifice, the Bible says. So obedience to God's word, amen, and then we won't fall prey to our false teachers out there. We'll know what God expects us to do, and we will do it. Freedom always comes at a price. When we put our complete faith and trust in the finished work of Christ, we can finally experience true freedom, complete forgiveness, and eternal life. A man may go to heaven. He may go without health, riches, or education, without honors, or even without friends. But he'll never go to heaven without Christ. The Bible tells me in Acts 4:12, neither is there salvation in any other, for there is no other name under heaven given among men whereby we must be saved. We can go to heaven without a lot of things, but we can't go to heaven without Christ. In John's Gospel, once again, my favorite chapter in the whole Word of God, because the Bible tells me there that Jesus loves me enough to save me and die for me. He loves me enough to come and get me. Amen. You know, I'm going to tell, while I'm here, I'm going to say this again. You might get tired of hearing me saying it, but I don't care. Amen. Because one day, some of you are going to see me lying up here in front in a coffin. And if that preacher, whoever does my funeral, says that the angels come and got Brother Gary last night or the day before or whatever, stop them. Because if you don't, I'm going to ask the Lord, let me raise up one more time. I'm going to clear the house. Because the Bible tells me a promise Jesus himself not only gave his disciples, but he gave it to me. And I personally claim it. It's in my Bible. I don't know if it's in your Bible or not, but I'm personally claiming John 14. He said, let not your heart be troubled. He believed in God, believe also me. In my Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, he said, I would have told you. And I like this. I go to prepare a place for you. And if I go to prepare a place for you, I will come again and receive you unto myself, that where I am, there he may be also. And he goes on, he says, whether I go, he know, and the way he know. Thomas, one of his disciples, said unto him, Lord, we know not whether I go, and how can we know the way? That's when Jesus said these words in John 14, 6. I am the way, the truth, and the life. And no man can come unto the Father except by me. I like that. You can't get to heaven any other way than through the blood of Jesus Christ. He is the door. Amen. He is the door. And you'll never experience freedom in your life unless you come by the door. So get the kinks out of your hose or your life today. Don't let the kink, amen, of distraction get you. Don't let the kink of temptation get you. Don't let the kink of false teaching grab you and stop your freedom in Christ Jesus today. Trust him today. If you never trusted him, friend, today is the day to experience the freedom in your life by accepting him into your life today. If you confess your sin, he's faithful and just to forgive you, amen, and cleanse you from all unrighteousness. No one can give you a new start in life but Jesus Christ. And I'm glad, amen, he chooses to forgive and to forget. I got to get down and do something. I got to get down off the ladder. Get down off the ladder of life today. Kneeled before God and get the kinks out so the Spirit can flow through you today. Let us stand. Our Heavenly Father, God, as I come to you today, Lord, I am grateful and thankful for this day, and thank you for your words that have been heard through song and through your word today, Lord. We know our greatest freedom lies with you, Lord. The freedom that this nation enjoys came from you, Lord. And Father, the freedom that we experience as believers in Christ Jesus only comes from you.